when you're 400 pounds and you've got horizontal stripes, it's a weird thing to look at.
What is this, basketball or baseball?
In football. Both Chicago people or just Russ?
I'm Illinois to Chicago. Springfield to Chicago.
Springfield to Chicago.
And Lianne was Chicago, I think, by marriage.
No, I'm L.A. I'm no Chicago.
I'm just sticking with L.A.
Yeah, I'm sticking with L.A. Yeah.
So how did you start in the business? Because I think you started first, right?
I don't know. Did I start first? I 78, 79. Is that about the same time?
Yeah, probably about the same time.
I went up. I started running Steppenwolf Theater when I was in 78, 79, Chicago, and which I did by fluke. I had gone up there to visit Malkovich, and they had a meeting where the guy that was, it was a real mom and pop operation at the time, and the guy that ran it said, "I'm called you all together because we're out of money. We have no prospects for money. I'm suggesting that the theater close down and I quit." And that was the meeting.
That's a good meeting.
And so John said, "Well, man, why don't you do it? You can write a grant and stuff." I was like, okay. But
so it was just nothing better to do? You figured?
I was working as a lobbyist at the time in Springfield, and which is what I was sort of trained to do. And believe it or not, at that particular period of time, I couldn't imagine anything sleazier than politics.
And then you got in show business.
You got in show business, and I still think there's nothing sleazier than politics.
Are they very...
That show business is not as sleazy as politics. Or at least the world that we live in, you know.
I'm sure the clean side, relatively.
Well, I'm sure that if you get down into the world of, you know, what we would call the carrion pickers that piece little bits of movies together for this and that, you know, mm-hmm. and make movie off money off product. We don't make product yet. Yeah.
But you and Lianne make the choice not to, on the top side, against the carry-in at the bottom, you have the guys at the top who are, you know, who are producing product and stamping things and making more of that. You guys have chosen not to go that direction at all, really. There's really no evidence of it at all in your resumes.
Yeah, I don't think we actually chose not to do it, but we just started. I think when we started the company, we were brought together by material. So, and I think, you know, we started together on a play. That's how we started. So we started doing a play together at Steppenwolf. We did a play that John directed, which we couldn't get going as a movie. And so we decided to do it as a play. Mm-hmm. And then right after that, we did Ghost World.
So it was... You had worked with Terry's Wigoff before, right?
Yeah, I'd worked on Crumb, and we had a script of Ghost World when Russ, John, and I got together. And so we decided to make that our first film.
So had you produced any film at that point?
Yeah, I did Miles from Home with Gary Sinise and Mice and Men with Gary and...
So you were really
Man in the Iron Mask, and
you weren't just like the Steppenwolf guy who was working with the guys who you were hands-on.
Oh, you mean when I went to Chicago?
No, when you did.
But when we got together as a company.
No, when you did those movies, when you did those movies with Gary and John.
We were moving from. What had happened was, you know, I'd produced 50 plays in Chicago, mm-hmm. then we'd kind of gone to New York and done some plays in New York, and it just seemed like. It was about that time to make a transition to movies. People were mm-hmm. calling and saying, you know, remember there was a period of time where, when video first started, where if you could get certain cast together at a particular price point of $4 to $5 million, they were looking for those titles in the video thing. Mm-hmm. If you opened in 400 theaters, remember all those companies around that time that opened up and said, the Cinecoms and all those kind of things,
Vestron.
Where they were Vestron, all those companies that were playing that game, mm-hmm. and so then people like Gary and John and all those people that were right at that age were like, yeah, you can do a movie now if you mm-hmm. follow these particular rules. So it was like, okay, let's do that.
So, sorry.
I worked for one of those companies.
Yes.
So I worked for A&M Records for mm-hmm. the film division, and in the film division you didn't have to make any money. That was, you know, the record company made the money, and the film mm-hmm. division was not responsible for making any money. And so we started right after that to work together.
Because you were looking forward to not making any money, or
Polygram took over A&M, and they wiped out they didn't think the idea of not making money was really a business agenda, mm-hmm. And so they replaced everybody who had been at the film department, and the entire company was sold. And so
ultimately you were working for Focus that whole time. Yeah. Didn't exist yet.
Ouch.
No, that's rude.
Is it? Like one buys the other.
Yeah. No. Who was it at that? That was when. Propaganda was part of that group, right?
Yeah, Propaganda.
Who's really the only survivor?
Yeah, not really. They didn't survive either. Everybody jumped out.
Oh, it became something else.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. Everybody went independent.
The evolution. So that was an opportunity to actually have, kind of be able to do independent films that were actually independent-minded at a decent price.
Yeah.
The budgets were actually fairly significant because of the video at that point, yeah?
It was $5 million. You knew that the moment, it was $5 million, and if you could open it, and if they put it in 400 screens, then whatever the video, you know, whatever they paid you in video was going to pay you back, and you weren't going to lose money. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, everybody did that for a few minutes, and then all of a sudden the video business went, you know what, I don't need all of those movies. I'd like to have 14 shelves of Arnold Schwarzenegger movies, and then a little section of those movies, mm-hmm. and then those companies went like that.
So the deal with Blockbuster killed independence yet again.
Yeah. Kind of, you know.
So did it change for you guys in terms of, now at this point you're a team, you're a group,
right.
You got a machine going. Does it change how you, what you're trying to make, or how what you're getting made, or how many movies you're making, or are you still kind of just trying to figure out a different way to fund?
Well, we have figured over the years, I mean, we've been doing it for 15 years, so maybe more. So, you know, as the climate changes, we change. So sometimes we have an overall deal, sometimes we don't. We had an overall deal with an English company. We had an overall deal when we first started with UA. We had a deal with Mandate. So, you know, our idea is just to keep afloat and to make our own material. So we develop, and I think the trick is to figure out how to keep the machine going, and that means that we were just explaining to somebody that we've had like 5 offices in the last 8 years, because sometimes we close up the office when we go off to make a movie, and sometimes we just, you know, we figure out a way to make sure that we keep our development slate going and the people that we're working with going as we're making movies. But we go off to make our movies. We don't, we develop and then we go off and produce them.
Which is how you like it.
Yeah. You hand make them.
And is that the fun? I mean, is that when you guys have your fun, or is there part of it that you enjoy doing more than other parts, or is it?
Not for me. I love the development process. The part that's I think the part that wears us out is the pitching, the selling, the explaining. And one of the things that people expect but's not true is that it doesn't get easier after your last movie. So even if the movie does well and the last two do well or the last three do well, you still start over when you go out to pitch.
Groundhog Day. David Putnam said that in his mm-hmm. book after, you know, after he, what was it?
Columbia?
The Midnight thing. No, before he came to Columbia when he was still producing.
Yeah.
And they're like, wow, you really taken the town by storm. He goes, are you kidding? Every single time. It's like Groundhog Day.
Yeah.
You know, well, love your stuff. What's this one? You know?
That seems like, difficult, yeah.
But it's the way it is. And one of the things that we just in terms of how do you navigate the way the world changes, you know, when we were young, we would go to AFM, we'd meet all those people, or you'd go to camp. I mean, you know what I mean? You'd meet all those people, and you'd try and figure out who was a crook and who wasn't, and who you could do business with, and all that kind of stuff. We tried to do it, put movies together in those various ways as well, and then you evolve from that, and then you start to know the town a little bit better, and then you try and figure out who those people are, and so the one, you know, I guess our two big lessons that we learn is that one is that we have to work. We have to work. We have to do it. We're not lunchers. Mm-hmm. We have to just go make movies. And even sometimes in those overall deals, what happens is you're kind of working for them and not for you. Mm-hmm. And so there's a trade-off those ways too. And so I think we've kind of decided our best way through it is just to keep making stuff until they tell us we can't.
So you guys have become built marriages, it seems, with certain directors, Jason Reitman being the most mm-hmm. obvious of them. Since his second movie, how did you guys hook up with him after his first movie?
On the second movie, we've actually done four with
but
him.
You weren't on,
no,
on,
so we weren't on
Smoking.
Thank You for Smoking.
You weren't on Smoking, right?
We were not.
Right.
What happened was we were interested in him. We wanted the book Thank You for Smoking. And we tried to get the rights to it. Mel Gibson owned the rights to that book for a decade or something like that.
I remember, yeah.
And so we were very curious to see what the movie was going to be. And I think Mandate at the time was, they were less curious than we were. And so we didn't get a chance to meet Jason and until we had a second round where our first director left and we went and looked. And the first person we met with was Jason the second time. And he had been wanting, we didn't know, but he really wanted to make that movie. He really wanted it. And his passion was convincing, you know.
And it just clicked in terms of?
It did. I mean, we had met, I think we met easily, we easily met 30 directors, and by the time we had met all of those directors and discussed that script, it was pretty obvious. He came in for a meeting and it was obvious to us, and then it went very quickly. So it was lucky. It was perfect timing for him and perfect timing for us. And he, I think it was a different experience. I think he'd done his first movie with people that he'd gone to college and high school with, and mm-hmm. We had developed the material with Diablo, and so I think it was new for him to collaborate with producers, but it went well. So we headed off. He was a little, reluctant in that relationship, and it went really well. It went well from the start of pre-production. So, and his casting was phenomenal, and so that was our first thing with him.
So did the ongoing marriage with young adult come from more Diablo than Jason, or is that just a mixture, just fit another good fit? Or
no, we had done a movie in between. We had produced a film with Jason in between, mm-hmm. and then we had the script of young adult, which we got from Diablo, and we took it to him, and he said it was not good timing, and then he thought about it, and then he changed his mind and came back.
He was writing Labor Day at the time, and he was hoping to make that, and it turned out the cast that he wanted wasn't available.
Because it was kind of like Charlize wasn't available for young adult, and then became
available. Yeah. Well, with Charlize, he said, you know, he read the script and he said, I know if she's available, I'll make the movie. Mm-hmm. And so that was it.
She magically came forth.
Yeah.
And if she'll play Katherine Heigl. Just kidding,
Just
Liz.
Kidding.
So where did you start with Steven? Steven's kind of like the find of this year, one of the big finds of this year, I'd say.
Yeah. Yeah, we found Steven. We found the book through an assistant of ours who mentioned, we'd asked him what book, if he could make any book into a movie, and he had read this when he was in college, and neither of us had heard of it. And we found out that he was writing the script at a meeting, and we dogged him for about a year and a half while he was writing the script. And then when he was done, we had a meeting with him. And
was he not interested in selling the book and wanted to do the script himself?
No,
was kind of, he was writing.
It was a decade. It was a decade. This was his baby.
It was his baby.
This was the way it was going to be. He was going to write that script. No one's going to see it till he was done. Then he was going to decide who was going to help him make the movie.
Yeah. Mm. And it was an interview. It was a definite, I mean, it was funny. It's one of those things where our first meeting at Farmers Market, it was one of those things where we were both, it was a definite checkout both ways. Because the idea of somebody writing a somewhat autobiographical novel that they've adapted, which they want to direct, is pretty much a no-no on our side. It's just, it was frightening. So.
And there was that one other factor, which he brought up almost immediately, which is that he has a trunk of letters from people who had read that book, who it affected so much, kept them from doing harm to themselves, it changed their life in some way, and in a sense, the ghosts in that trunk had an enormous influence on him and how he had, how he felt he had to approach it, which is scary as hell. To try and who? I mean, how do we? We've just got to try and make a best movie we can out of it. We can't think about them and all the other stuff.
So you have a first-time screenwriter, first-time director who has ghosts and has this weight carrying on his shoulders that you guys have to somehow manage.
Yeah, but it was there were, I mean, and there were a lot of rules and a lot of I mean, there were a lot of things that would point in the opposite direction. But you know, we decided in that first meeting, it was a really, it was strange because one of the things is that you have to let go of the novel, and Stephen was really clear that he was not going to let go of anything, and that he wanted to be absolutely faithful. But we had a couple of those meetings, and he was so smart about the book and about the kind of movie he wanted to make and about casting. And so we were cautious and we were won over. And then it took about a year and a half to get the financing.
But part of that, I mean, not part of it, but one of the factors when you have a situation where you have a first-time director like that, you want the time. You want all that time. You have to see how they're going to react in various situations. You have to see if they'll do the work, if they'll compromise in any. It took longer than we wanted to get the financing, but it kind of, we needed that time to, to get him in the right place in a weird way.
Yeah, and we did a couple of drafts, and we adjusted our thought about casting and.
It's 160 pages.
It was long.
Another good item. Another good part. So did you bring out the? Did you bring the patience, I guess, of that kind of vibe of the idea of okay, you know, the thing is going to take what it's going to take. I mean, I'm sure you're chewing on your nails through part of it, but is that something that you learned through doing a lot of theater, a lot of shows, or something you learned in the process of being producers together over a number of years? Or
I think producers together more than theater in that case, and just seeing how first-time directors really have to be turned in. I mean, you don't become a director because you give yourself the title. You know what I mean? There, you got to go to, in a weird way, to boot camp, and boot camp is a lot of people saying no, for one thing, and where normally it's like, what? I'm the director. I get everything I want. You know.
Mm-hmm.
They have to learn a lot of things in that period of time. And it's not like, oh, we have to have this time because this is the process and you won't be a good director without it. It's just because financing is hard to find. First-time directors are hard to finance. A lot of rejections, a lot of ways to get financing. There's just a lot of meetings and a lot of disappointment, a lot of phone calls.
Yeah. and part of what we do is we're both pressing forward, and you know, we're patient, but I would not call us delicate. So part of what we're doing is, you know, we're protecting we're assessing what is, you know, most essential about what Stephen is doing and what we have to protect in the script, in his vision. And we're, you know, as you go through, there are things that get left behind. And part of what we're doing as we go through is assessing what is essential and what are the things where we can't compromise.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, at the start of that process with a first-time director, everything is essential. And part of what they learn as they go through is to, you know, as everybody does, is what are your priorities and what really is inviolate and what you can compromise on. And I think one of the things that happens, one of those relationships that evolve, if you're lucky, between the producer and the director, is that the director really trusts that you know what those things are, and that as you go forward, that you're going to keep the baby safe. And that's really because part of what happens in production is the baby gets passed back and forth. And man, if you have a director that feels that he has to hold on to all things all the time, then it's going to be difficult. And also, it's too much. It's too much. Then you don't get the benefit of having a producer.
How many first-time directors have you guys done?
I think it's eight.
Eight?
Now, I think we may have six, because there's Gary before that, maybe, or something. But John, Terry, Lawrence Dunmore, Stephen, John Walter.
Yeah.
Had Diego done something before that first one?
What?
Had Diego Luna done something before?
No, Diego.
No. Okay,
Diego.
Good.
Yeah, Diego. There we go.
Good for you.
And you're back in business with him.
Yes, we are. Yeah. We're going there tonight.
And oddly enough, we're speaking to Michael Pena this afternoon.
Oh, are you really?
It's a small world.
Fantastic.
But I guess that means, because we go back to work with them, that we're good at telling somebody, telling when somebody's a director. And the fact that we're getting them on their maiden flight is not as important to us as the fact that they're a director, and we feel like we can tell.
Yeah. Yeah, but the other thing is, once they know, and part of that process is, we don't work for them. We work for the movie, and that's what they understand in that process, that if we're having a little problem at a particular moment, it has nothing to do with anything other than we're trying to keep the movie in mind, and you may be thinking of something else, and we're working for the movie, and we're trying to make the best movie possible from what we, you know, from what we've got.
So do you guys have a sense of an arc in this whole experience at this point? Is there a sense of, okay, now we're, this is what we do, we, you know, put on the boots and go to work, and this is how we do it? Or is it just whatever battle you have to fight for each movie that you decide you want to be involved in, each project you want to be involved in, that's a different set of armor?
Yeah, no, I don't think, I think it's just, we can't go back. I guess that's the thing, is that when we decide that we're going to make a movie, we assume it's going to be just terrible getting it made. I'm talking people into it. It's not going to relate to the last thing. It's not going to be exactly like the last thing that succeeded. So we sort of assume that, and I think we don't get rattled by that. And the way that we work, we really have to, once we make that commitment, we have to make the movie. And so that means that we don't have to, you know, we don't really think about it after we make that commitment. We're not judging at every threshold. Should we go to the next threshold? Mm-hmm. Once we're in. And so that takes a lot of pressure off, because you're in it to the end. And I think that the writers and the directors feel that, and so, you know, we're in it together and we go. And I think the kind of through line for us is that it starts with the material. And when we go in and we have those sales pitches with studios or financiers, you know, we're making movies for an audience. So we're making movies that we love, but we're making movies that we're convinced an audience will love. And so, and we're true believers. So we're good at the in those pitches. And it does help the longer we do this. That track record, I guess it helps a little.
Well, you guys are, in a way, I mean, almost as, if you see the name Mr. Mudd, or you see your guys' names on a picture, it's almost as significant as seeing somebody like Joel Silver's name on a picture. I mean, or Bruckheimer. There's
excellent.
So completely different, but yet there's an expectation of a, you know,
of an action film.
Yes, of an action film. But you know that you're an impromptuer, in a way, and obviously your work, which we don't, those of us on the outside don't think about as much on a day-to-day basis. But it's going to manifest itself in some way, even if the picture is imperfect or the best picture of the year or whatever it is,
right.
That somehow there's that something you guys bring to it that's pretty consistent.
Thank you.
I think that's true. I mean, I think that what we do is add value to the movie. That's all. We try and make it better. Just the 10%, 15%, 25%.
Can you ever measure? Is there ever a sense of actually being able to figure out?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, there is.
I would say no.
Yeah, there is.
Yeah.
Because some of them you just kind of go, well, that was a really easy, smooth ride, and, you know, what did we do here? You know, mm-hmm. Well, we helped make the ride smooth and easy. And then other ones, you go, that never would have even happened. So I think it's measurable.
Mm. So are there things you haven't done that you ache to do in terms of, besides specific projects that you may have in your bag at the moment? I mean, are there things like we really want to make an epic? We really want to make a musical? We want to do a superhero movie?
I think we'd really like to do a kids movie that's a family film for younger kids. Would love to do that. And I think we'd really like to do a big film with, a thinking person's action film. Yeah, I think we'd like to do that.
And is the muscle group any different to go do those things?
Not a bit.
No. Good script, good director, cast.
Not really, not a bit. I mean, your dolly grip is the same dolly grip. I mean, our dolly grip on Young Adults, same dolly grip on Lincoln and mm-hmm. on Battleship. I mean, you know what I mean? So it's the same crew doing slightly different stuff, you know?
And has anything really changed that much aside from the funding side of it from the earliest days of you guys doing this together?
I think the business is changing all the time. When we first started, the only significant changes that would happen in the business is when there would be a union agreement that would come up, and it was like, oh, you knew every 7 years there'd be something going on, and it would mm-hmm. there'd be some shift in some way, shape, or form. I think the business shifts all the time now. I think the model shifts. I think that, you know, the thresholds for cast and money and how people release things and where the core audience is. I think all that stuff shifts a lot. And, I don't think we follow, I think for us, we don't follow any of those trends. We just keep making our stuff, but we have to keep in mind what's out there and how it works. We fall in love with stuff and we have to make it.
Yeah, and I think the no's hurt. Less and are less confounding. I think when we first started and we would go out, like with Juno, and a lot of people said that's a great script, but I just couldn't take the risk of making it. I think after you do it for a while, we throw off the no's much more easily, and we just go on to the next. You only need one person to say yes, and I think that is clearer to us now than it was when we were doing this 15 years ago.
And what is your post when you're done? What is your relationship with the movie? I mean, not financial, but business-wise, but do you carry them with you all the same way? Do you, you know, revel in the ghost world obsession of so many people that are still out there obsessing on ghost world all these years later? Or is it, you know, Juno did this many dollars and therefore that's the biggest success, or is it?
I don't know. I have a strange relationship to movies after they're done. I feel totally disconnected from them after they're done. I feel utterly attached to them while we're developing and when we're making them and in post, I feel just like this to them. And as soon as they're done, as soon as they hit the theaters, I it's like that umbilical cord gets cut and I see them completely different.
I mean, they're kids, you know, some of them you're just, oh, isn't that, oh, look, that's on TV. You know, oh, look, that's on, here and there. But because we do so sort of hand make them that you're working on it all the way through the DVD box and the quotes on the back and stuff, by that, there's a point where you have to go, okay, next, you know, mm-hmm. because you, it's not like when the movie's finished shooting or when it's finished editing, we're done with it. We get phone calls today on, you know, awards campaigns and various things like that, and it just keeps going.
It does feel like you're still kind of in the middle of Perks.
Yeah.
After all that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And hopefully through March.
Yeah.
Well, hopefully.
Thank you.
Hopefully. I mean, good actors in that movie.
But you're already
good screenplay.
You're already moving towards the next thing. You're already ready for the next. Or you've already made.
We've got two. We've got two in the editing room.
Yeah.
Labor Day and Chavez.
And
so we're looking, trying to get John back on the boards. Malkovich. We're going to try and do that next year. And we have we're out to a big actor for another movie, and we'll see how that works out. And so we're going to try and get, you know, two together for this coming year.
Yeah, and we're in the midst of a doc right now also that's going on in New York. But, you know, we're going right out to have a conversation about Perks and to have a conference call about making sure that Perks gets the amount of attention that it deserves. So we don't let go easily, but we will eventually.
And the Holy Ghost of the trio does seem to be John. Is his relationship in terms of how you all three work together changed over these years, or
yes,
is it still kind of the same in certain ways?
It's changed. It's changed for a number of reasons. One is John doesn't live around us anymore. Mm-hmm. So we see him less than we used to. He's still up to speed on most of the stuff that we're up to and involved in some and not involved in others. I think the really fun change with John is, you know, 10 years ago, anytime we did anything, it would be like, you know, so John Malkovich's company did this or that or this, mm-hmm, or that. And I think that's evolved on to it just being Mr. Mudd, you know.
Yeah.
And I think I remember when he was at Sundance, he had something at Sundance, and it was right after Juno came,
yeah,
out, and everybody was coming up to him to congratulate him on that, and you knew that was sort of John's graduation from into, oh my goodness, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
The company's moved on from what was perceived as some sort of weird actor vanity thing.
Mm-hmm.
Of course,
which it never really was.
Really was, but it's always how it's perceived whenever an actor's involved in something, you know.
Well, he's such a low profile, you know, kind of quiet guy.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, he is in a weird way.
In a weird way, with a loud sport coat.
But he has such a presence in the world, you know. It's,
yeah,
like people just kind of like, their eyes roll back in their heads as,
yeah,
he walks in the room.
Yeah, no, it's true. It's true.
And it's been a pretty fun ride.
Great.
And you can't imagine doing anything else, I guess?
Think about it late at night, but no.
No, not really. I mean, look, do you go, there's always a point where you go, oh, could I be working in an orphanage somewhere? Yeah, sure. But just in terms of skill sets and experience and stuff, still like it.
And working with actors is just like working in an orphanage.
And we love actors.
You do.
We love actors. No, seriously.
I see you guys hanging out with actors all the time. Actually.
All the time. Ask this kid if,
yeah,
he enjoyed his time on the set when it's coming in, you know? Because part of making a movie is putting them in the right place where they're going to make the best movie.
Yeah.
And, in fact, we were just having coffee, and I didn't have to do it, but we were just having talking about the last movie he made.
Mm.
And, you know, things like knowing when to call actors in and, mm-hmm, when not to call actors in is a huge thing. And that's, mm-hmm, just making sure that your AD has the confidence to not call an actor in 5 hours before they shoot, you know,
mm-hmm,
so that they're not kind of wondering what the hell's going on. They're ready to go.
Mm-hmm.
And we kind of do that too, you know, so.
You're creating atmosphere the same way the director does, but just